stain is beautiful.
I like the paint, the stain. So we started doing that. There's something else that we did. I don't remember what it was. I don't essay weave. I'm going to use that term really well. We don't really do a whole lot here. John does a lot here. I do figure out how to do that stuff. Troil fixed the altar so that it's not flowing all over, which was really cool. And she put in a She built, sewed some things for under the garage door so that my feet aren't cold during service. So all of that has happened this week. Other announcements and prayer requests. Prayer and prayer service is tonight at 6. Is that right? Is it 6 o'clock? I should know that because I have to speak. So,
you have to be there.
I do have to be there, and I didn't know I had to say more than what I already had planned. I said I had a little panic attack yesterday when I started reading. And then I went. And some of this doesn't even make sense for what they told me, so I got to figure that out this afternoon. John and Bo are coming home today from their hog hunt. Apparently there's some really good stories of Bo crawling, army crawling through the grass trying to get to Pogs and not succeeding, but it will be fun to listen to their stories, I'm sure, when they get back. It's a good father-son time. Baby Riker that we've been praying for those of you who aren't AFT, his mom is a teacher at Prairie Hills who I teach with. He was diagnosed with something that's about this long of a brain. I don't know what it is, but he's 2 months old now, and he needs a bone marrow transplant at the end of this month to hopefully cure whatever that big long word is. And so we've been praying for him that he stays healthy and that he can have the transplant and they can get on with life, but that's been a rough situation there. There is lots of COVID going around. Lots and lots and lots of it. My hospital friend said it's full again. And I don't know. I know what full means, but I don't know if full means that ICU is full and that means that everybody else is in trouble, or if it just means infusions. I don't really know what full means. But I seem to know a lot of people with COVID or have recently had COVID. It seems to be, John and I were just talking about it. We don't know if it's more prevalent this year than in the past, or if it's just finally hitting our friends. So lots of COVID's in the school, all that kind of stuff. Kids have bounced back pretty fairly easily. Trying to think if there's anything else that I was supposed to tell you guys. I think that was it. So prayer requests. Yes.
I have an interview with Jackson Dario Tuesday, so I just want to get prepared for that, and then also for my wife's arm to get better, and for my daughter not to.
Okay, tell me what your name is again.
What's that?
Tell me what your name is again.
Steven.
No, I know what your name is.
Oh, Erica.
Erica, thank you.
Right now is she's also tested positive. So just that whole household there. she was pretty ill, but she, the doctor is trying to, you know, hold off on her until she's COVID free. So they'll let her be pregnant, hopefully. I mean, unless baby boy decides to, you know, come out anyway, you know, they can't control that, but hopefully they're going to let her be pregnant until the 16th, and then they'll possibly help baby out. So, but hopefully, you know.
Healthy and able to do the things that need to be done. Lord, I am so thankful for this day. day. Thankful for this opportunity to worship with you, Lord. We are thankful for all the things you are doing here at Mary Magdalene, from the concrete outside to the paint to the lights to the altar coverings to those who are asking to volunteer that I have no idea how to have them volunteer at this point. Lord, we just continue to ask your guidance, your blessings, Lord, as we move forward. May your name be praised. Amen.
Amen.
Let's see if the technology works today. We should probably pray for that, too.
Speaker's not on.
Did it shut off again?
Yeah.
What is it doing that?
Energy efficiency, yeah, they all put off.
Your song again.
first reading comes from Isaiah 43, verses 1 through 7. But now, thus says the Lord your Creator, O Jacob, and he who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you, and through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I have given Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in your place, since you are precious in my sight, since you are honored and I love you. I will give you other men in your place and other peoples in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east and gather you from the west. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not hold them back. Bring my sons from afar and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Everyone who is called by my name and whom I have created for my glory, whom I have formed, even whom I have made. The word of the Lord. Our second reading today is going to come from Acts chapter 8, verses 14 through 17. Now when the apostles in Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For he had not yet fallen upon them, they had simply been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then they began laying their hands on them, and they were receiving the Holy Spirit. The word of the Lord.
No, there's a lot of things that we believe in and we put our faith into. But as Christians, and especially in this church, people ask us what we believe. We can definitely reference the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Amen. I believe Mr. Ryan has a message for us tomorrow, so
let's get it out.
There goes that. We're going to do fine,
brother. So, yes, like y'all said, my name is Ryan. For those of you that haven't met before, I was concerned there was not enough room for all my stuff up here. That's because I'm kind of all over the place with this. Has anybody here celebrated Epiphany before? Good. Okay, very good. I have never celebrated Epiphany early in this church. And so John asked me if I could come and do this. And I said, that's sometimes where my pride and ego get in my way because I'm going to say yes immediately to things without thought. And I said, do you have a topic? And he said, well, yes, it's Epiphany Sunday. And I said, you have a topic. And he said, you have a topic, Jesus. And I said, perfect. I feel like he's kind of picking on me. And so I reached out to my dad a lot, and I called him and I said, hey, my brother asked me if I could lead on Sunday. And he goes, oh, what are you going to teach about? And I said, Epiphany Sunday. And he said, oh, what are you going to teach about? And I said, exactly. I'm a little upset that we haven't done this before. And so it's going to be an interesting journey for those of you that have never celebrated Epiphany. I will make this look very good, probably. because the ones that have some knowledge of it, if I start doing that, do this or something. last week we started Epiphany, and we looked at the kind of what Epiphany made, and I thought very early for me to hit the nail on the head was kind of like, like it's this brilliant idea. And up until a week ago or so, that's what Epiphany meant to me. It didn't have any further meaning than that. I think at church growing up, we obviously celebrated Christmas and Easter, but we didn't go by a liturgical calendar and do these. And so I got out this Orthodox Bible that church gave me, it was with dads, and started with the definition in here. And I'd like to read that. This said Epiphany, literally a breaking through from above, and it means the manifestation or theophany of God. The examples of epiphanies are the burning bush, the transfiguration of Christ, 12 days after Christmas, which is where we find ourselves today, the Feast of Epiphany, honoring the manifestation of the whole Trinity, the baptism of Christ. Of course, I didn't know what a theophany was, so we'll go back here a few pages and read that also. So the theophany is a manifestation of God in his uncreated glory. It refers also to Christ's resurrection appearances. The revelation of the Holy Trinity and the baptism of Christ is the greatest theophany. It is celebrated, like we said, on Epiphany, which was January 6th. And the other theophanies that are found throughout the Bible are God appeared to Abraham. And also we find it, that he appeared to Jacob and Abraham. Those are both found in Genesis. And so, for the last 10 days, I've been studying through this. I don't know if I'm any closer to understanding this than when I started. So, I don't want to get into this and talk to a lot of people, but last week, the lesson that John gave was on Jesus being revealed to the Jewish people at the temple. And so this week, there's two things that happen across a lot of churches. So some of the churches are going to be celebrating the Magi coming. So that's the revelation of Jesus to the Gentile world. And a fair amount of churches are focused on Jesus' baptism. And some others are going to be serving on who knows what. Last year when we started, we were here on Palm Sunday. And had a beautiful service outside in the dirt. There was no buildings. There was a whole bunch of foundations. And to come this far, like, I was here Tuesday, and walk around how amazed I am. I'm not a construction guy, so, I'm like, just totally blown away by this. And after that, church that I left, a friend of ours was getting her baby dedicated in a church. And so for Palm Sunday, they had the kids come and sing a song, and they dedicated the baby, and then they delivered a message about tithing. And so I'm not going to do that. I'm going to stick to what's going on. In my notes it says, look at how others celebrate Epiphany. That's it. Like I said, the Magi is one of the celebrations that they look at. And that's kind of a big deal. I thought about this. Our nativity scene, the Magi were there when we put it up, I noticed on Facebook, people were moving their Magi ever closer as they were getting closer to Epiphany. I had no idea what that even meant, I think it's a, for me, this has been probably one of the most challenging to study through, just because there's so much that's going on with this short little act, I guess, if you will. So we're going to go into Matthew 3. And I brought my New Living Translation Bible. I like the way it reads. I'll help you not stumble over my words. I was going to use the New King James, but I couldn't get through it very well. So we're going to be in Matthew 3 and chapter 3, verse 15, and it's the title of my Bible, Baptism of Jesus. Then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John, but John didn't want to baptize him, I am the one who needs to be baptized by you, he said. So why are you coming to me? But Jesus said, it must be done because we must do everything that is right. So then John the Baptist baptized. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, and I am fully pleased with him. And so, as we look and we start at verse 13, you know, we see that John the Baptist is already there baptizing. And if we back up a few verses to the beginning of the chapter, we can get an idea of how many people were there. Jesus meant to announce, this is my Son from heaven. Why not announce when Jesus turned water into wine, when Jesus healed the lame, or raised the dead? Why now? And then he falls out of it. That's the digging part. And I'm still digging on that a lot. But what I've come to realize is that as difficult as I made that question, it's really got a pretty simple answer. And I feel like the answer is right there when Jesus says to fulfill all righteousness. And the first thing I did was, well, it must be a prophecy in the Old Testament that says Jesus is going to be baptized in this particular fashion, on this particular day, by this particular guy. No specific instance of that. And so as we go through, you know, and see that we realize there's going to be a number of people, including religious leaders, future disciples. And I have it written as it shows that in Matthew 3:5, but I don't see that. As well. And so if we go to verse 13 and 14, you know, why did John the Baptist try to stop him? And like I said, John knew that Jesus was his father's son. And when we look past that, I mean, I have a hard time putting myself in a situation. Like, it's easy for me on the outside looking at him, like from a distance, to see how this all goes down. But to be standing there and have this encounter and knowing, like, you know, that God has revealed to him that this is my moment. And so in John 1, we have a conversation where John the Baptist was testifying about it. In John 1:29, it says, the next day John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, here's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He is the one I was talking about when I said, soon man's coming who is far greater than I am, for he existed long before I did. I didn't know he was the one, but I had been baptizing with water in order to point him out to Israel. And so as all this is happening, and he's having this realization, this revelation, he's going to baptize Jesus. He has no idea really what is going to happen next. And so as we're moving through Matthew 3 and we get to verse 15, we know Jesus was sinless. He does not need purification. But by making the purification of humanity of his own, he washes away humanity's sin, grants regeneration, reveals the Holy Spirit. His baptism is necessary for the fulfillment of God's righteous salvation. Jesus enters the filthy, sinful waters of the world, and when he comes out, brings up and purifies the entire world again. And when I'm thinking of this, importance of it. Our focus is a lot. It's focused on the cross and the resurrection and all these things. And there's not a single most important thing that I can really say. I think it's natural that we focus on that because that is our mode of salvation. It starts there and our new covenant starts there. So as I was studying through this, this is as was pointed out as the most significant thing. Like, this had to happen. All these things have to happen before this point of Jesus being persecuted. And when I was reading through John's notes, I don't know when he did that, but he talked a little bit about Jesus being labeled with the transgressors. And at this point in time, he's kind of already probably labeled as somebody that these religious leaders don't care for very much. And so it's very interesting to me how this plays out through this course of history. So, last week we see the circumcision of Jesus and Simeon, and I believe it is Anna, possibly, is the other lady that's there. And they're all going crazy, God revealed to me that I would do this before I died. And so you have to think that other people took notice because there again, there's a lot of people in the temple always. And so from straight away, there's all these working things happening, the Magi are coming, Herod's aware of Jesus now, they flee to Egypt, and all this is building up to this point of epiphany, of revelation. And so, of course, John says, all right, I'm going to baptize you. Jesus responds, it must be done for everything that is right. And so after the baptism, Jesus comes up out of the water, the heavens were open, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on him. And a voice from heaven said, this is my beloved Son, and I'm fully pleased with him. So here's the part for me that got better. My first question to myself was, who heard that? Who was in the know of they actually heard God's voice versus they just heard perhaps a rumble of thunder? And when I had reached out to a couple of people about that, they gave me some reference back in John, the first chapter, similar. It kind of talks about I'll clear it off. That's what I'm going to do. I got to start doing better than this. If you saw my handwriting, I tried to get Trish to help me do this. And she's been very busy. That's my excuse. John 12:29. Not bad. You're lucky I'm running about 2 minutes. All over the place. So then a voice spoke from heaven saying, I've already been charged for it, I'll do it again. When the crowd heard the voice, some thought it was thunder, while others declared it was what it spoke to you. And so we see a time where some people heard and it revealed what he's saying, some didn't. And so I couldn't find anything specific that said, one, who all was there, there's lots of speculation, and then who heard it. And so for me, when I think if the only people who heard it was John the Baptist and Jesus, the Old Testament puts us in a way that says the testimony of two witnesses, is held as a truth while they work through that issue. And so if we apply what we see in John 12, then it's possible that a lot of people heard that. I would think that a lot of people heard and I think that as they witness the heavens open and this dove descend, that if they're not of there, probably hit their knees. And some of them were, you know, probably like, now it begins, you know. And they start this journey of actively working out a way to get rid of Jesus. And so I think at the time too, a lot of these people, they were no stranger to ceremonial washing and that in the Old Testament, two different things. We have a lot of symbolism with baptism in the Old Testament. You have Noah with the flood as the least of the baptism in the ark was the salvation. Save the human race in creation, and God makes a promise, he makes a covenant with Noah. And then we have Moses, which is as an infant spit in the basket, he's rescued by Pharaoh's daughter. And of course that is, you know, God's providence there for the working of what's gonna happen later. And if he would deliver Israel. And then also we have Moses part in the Red Sea. And God delivers his chosen people. The sea crashes on Pharaoh's army, ending, you know, their captivity there. And then it shows also that, you know, the children of Israel were falling around in this cloud. And so it shows that they were baptized in the cloud and the sea in a way. And as we move through that, we show how Joshua. And this one stood out to me the most. It's because he led Israel to the promised land, and he was blocked by the flooded Jordan River. And so they had to cross from one side to the other. And at that time, Joshua commands the priests to stand in the water. The waters split, and these people are able to go across into the promised land. And so then also we have to think of Jonah, who is directly tied in with Jesus' story later on. But Jonah runs from God and is thrown overboard from the ship. He spends a few days in the belly of a whale, in water, saved from the water. And then he takes the message to Israel, which he's supposed to do. And then the baptism, you know, part of that is this, you know, reference from Jesus' story back to that is, you know, blending the two in the comparison of that. And Jonah, I mean, obviously he tried to run and hide from what he's supposed to do. Jesus, who knows what's going to happen in a sense, knows what's going to happen in a sense, and he stays steadfast in this. And he went through everything through. He was begotten as a man and to endure the things that we endure. And then we go to John the Baptist in the New Testament. Baptism is a symbol of repentance of sin, and the Holy Spirit wasn't just freely poured out on people. We know that John the Baptist was anointed, so the Holy Spirit was on him. I wrestled with this idea that Jesus wasn't already anointed, and that the Holy Spirit coming at that time is a confirmation of these things. It's confirmation to John the Baptist and to everybody that Jesus is who he says he is. Jesus is who all these people speculated about when he was 12 years old in the temple, and they're all amazed and in awe, and he's just doing what's right, what's natural. I love that we touched on that last week, because when we looked at that piece in discipleship, my first thought was that, you know, 12-year-old teenager, I don't know how my kids respond, and, you know, it's like, duh, Mom, why wouldn't I? You know, but that's not the case. It really isn't. And that this caring nature of Mary and Jesus and all these things are at play. And when we start interjecting what we think, it really can get you into a place where you don't get this context, you don't get this understanding. And so there's quite a few different accounts in the gospel. The one in John's historical account, you know, briefly touches on it. And I like the one in Matthew the best, because it seems very specific. It's a detailed account, and I can draw a lot from it. So the last thing that I kind of have is have so many ghosts down here, and I don't even know which ones to really poke at. It takes me into this unknown. For me, the biggest thing that I took notice of is that John the Baptist is a symbolic repentance, a ceremony of washing, and he's preparing the way for Jesus. So Jesus comes and he takes this and he turns this symbolic thing into a sanctifying process. And that through his example of leading the way, and we're supposed to model ourselves after that, there's all these points of things that are happening that we're to look at and model after. So I have these two things that put together. And this is witnesses of Jesus' baptism. Obviously, John the Baptist was there because he baptized Jesus, but also all of John the Baptist's disciples. We might not realize that in the beginning, John had more disciples than Jesus did. As it says, all the country of Judea and all of Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. So there could have been thousands, and there when Jesus was baptized, including those who were waiting to be baptized. We have little doubt that there were also a lot of spectators who would be observing John from a distance. This surely included the religious leaders of the Jews, since they had questioned John about why he was baptizing people. If he weren't Elijah, the prophet or Christ. And so, there's always this, I think, a little seed of doubt, like this question. And I take the Bible very literally. I'm a firm believer that if you believe in the beginning, and you believe these last few words of Revelation, you have to believe every word in between. And so when I look at this and I try to play this out, I've never watched the show, so I've never even seen like a commentation of this to put it to you, so it's all fully in my head. God can list this insignificant thing to this holy, righteous, act of confirmation to the forerunner of Jesus and also to the world, if you will, through the people who are there and also through the Bible, of course. And so it's a confirmation a little bit in Acts 1:21 shows that a lot of the disciples were possibly there. It reads, so now I must choose a replacement for Judas from among the men who were witnessed the entire time we were traveling with the Lord Jesus. From the time he was baptized by John until the day he was taken from us, whoever is chosen will join us as a witness of Jesus' resurrection. And so we see that there were some qualifications to be the next chosen disciple or apostle, if you will. And in summary, you can see this kind of wraps it all up. And so John the Baptist, cousin of Jesus, and the one chosen by God to proclaim his covenant, was preaching in the wilderness and was baptizing all who would respond to his message, calling for repentance. As he was doing this, John was directing the people towards the one who would baptize them with the Holy Spirit. The Bible tells us that Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. Initially, John would not do this, saying that Jesus should baptize him. Jesus said to John, let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness. John consents. When Jesus came up from the water, the heavens opened, the Holy Spirit descends. The Bible records that the Spirit descended like a dove and alighted on him. When this happened, a voice came from heaven and said, this is my Son, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased. This was the voice of God the Father. Christ's baptism in the Jordan was a theophany and manifestation of God in the world, because it was the beginning of our Lord's public ministry. It was also the offering that the world granted a revelation of the Holy Trinity. All three persons were made manifest together. The Father testified from on high to the divine sonship of Jesus. Jesus received his Father's testimony, and the Holy Spirit seemed in the form of a dove, descending from the Father and resting on the Son. And that's our only time that we have this, and to get this Trinity that we hold dear to our hearts. And one of the things that Nicene Creed talks about in one's baptism for all believers, and that's what unites us. And so when I started, I asked who's celebrating the 50th and who's done this. And so across all these different denominations and different, I always say Protestant, but that's not the case. Christian, Orthodox, you know. And so, they don't have the same agreements on baptism, you know, but it has to happen. And I wrestled that a lot. And we have to have baptism to enter heaven. We have to have baptism for salvation. And there's two sides to everything. And that's where I found myself with a lot of difficulty coming with something that I'm sure of, right? And like I said, that's where my pride kind of gets me in trouble, because I'm very happy to say yes to things, and I do enjoy the challenge. But that revelation of the Trinity confirms for me that is what happens, because I take the Bible from start to finish, and I choose to believe it. There's times where I am, I'm like, there's no way that happened. Then I see these other miracles that happen, and I'm like, that's more substantial than this really to me, because I got to see it. And I always have found myself in my youth and in my 20s and 30s that I'm always seeking this burning bush experience. And all these burning bush experiences are in this book, the Bible, for God to reveal himself to us. And the way that he reveals himself at this epiphany, at this particular time, just means a lot to me. And to know that as we go through and act out our lives and walk it out like Jesus does, that as he's modeled the way, that it shows me that baptism is necessary. And I look at it as more than just a symbolic event, that there's a sanctifying event that happens at baptism. And I will admit, I think that not everybody that gets in the water fully comprehends what's going on there. But I still feel like at that point there's something happening that was planting the seed. And I think that in itself can be a little bit of a sanctifying event. And so the last thing I got was I was studying through is I found a epiphany prayer. I'm not sure where it came from. I didn't even look. I just read it and I really liked it. And I'd like to share that as we close. And it starts out, O Lord Jesus Christ, Heavenly King, we thank you that you have brought both Jews and Gentiles to hear your voice, and from their number, you have gathered and established your Holy Church. And it means a lot to me because I feel very undeserving. And it's not because of all the stuff I've done. It's not, I mean, I've had a very troubled past life to the point of to get to here today. And so I don't know that it means more to me than some other people. I think we all have the reality as we read through Scripture that we're undeserving. That what the cost and the price that was paid is priceless. And the result of that is that we get to live forever. And the good thing is sometimes I believe it's a bad thing if we have the free will to choose that. So I'll pull myself together here. Gather yourself for the church and perfecting your praise out of your mouth. Keep us in that wisdom which is revealed to the wise men. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may always seek you and your kingdom. Enable us to follow your holy word as those from the east by the rising star. Give us grace at all times and at all places to confess your holy name. Rule us by your Spirit so that the joys of your birth may increase in us. Hear our prayers and cries. Accept our offerings which you yourself have given us. The goal of our faith, the incense of our prayers, and the myrrh of our contrite hearts. Deliver us from the destructive ways of error and sin by the Holy Spirit. Lead us in the ways of peace and in the paths of righteousness. Grant us all, when this life is done, a participation in the joys of the year of Jubilee in heaven. And we shall praise and serve you, the Father who lives and reign in unity with the Holy Spirit, now and forever. I really appreciate the opportunity to be up here and share that with you.
I'm proud of you.
I don't think there was something to gain out of that. If not for you guys, there certainly was for me. And as I go through my week, I'm sure that I'll still be able to do this a little bit. And I'm actually glad for the discussion. It's been a very, very fun time for me. Well, I love you guys. Thank you for coming out.
We're going to take some time for meditation.
some answers. And just to come to the table, we have to confess to the Lord to empty ourselves so we can receive the gift that He gives us. If you guys are doing everything, Lord, I confess. To nurture us and to sanctify our body and give us this gift to you, Lord. And Lord, as we celebrate Epiphany weekend and the baptism of Jesus, like Brother Ryan was talking about, there's different meaning, symbolic reasons. Moses, the heart, it means different things, Lord. We thank you for those gifts. We thank you for the questions that we still have. And the opportunity to dig in and to try to figure out why, Lord. Well, Lord, we know as we dig in and as we dig deep, we know the answer. And the answer is you, Lord Jesus. We love you. And we come and we bow before you. The night Jesus was betrayed, sins for you and for me. Whenever you do this in remembrance of me. And Father, now we celebrate the memorial of your son Jesus.
proclaim his death until he returns. We affirm his life by receiving his grace and pouring his grace upon others. Gather us by his holy communion into one body in your Son. Transform us into a living sacrifice of praise. And have you join with me the prayer that our Lord Jesus taught us to pray?
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to your table, Lord, let us remember the sacrifice and the gift that you have given us. Lord, you've given us the opportunity of free will, calling you here, we love you. Lord, let us remember that when we come to you with surrender. We come to you with open arms like a child comes to a father for love, mercy, tenderness, kindness. Lord, we come to you with open arms. We just thank you for all your new blessings. We thank you for all your love and the sacrifice you have made for your people.
Thank you.
Drew kind of mission, our thought process and prayer is a little bit different as we will serve. So our prayer, our blessing is the Franciscan blessing. May God bless you with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships so that you may live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger and injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people so that you may wish for justice, freedom, and peace. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in this world so that you can do what others claim cannot be done. Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. We humble ourselves and we honor you, Lord. Lord, I ask that you would bless all of us with your mercy and grace and allow us to serve as we are a mission. To have that discomfort and the anger and injustices. That when we see something that we know is not right, Lord, to stand up and do something about it instead of just let it pass by. Lord, we ask that you allow us to do things, say things, and think things that are pleasing to you, Lord. Lord, it's a rough world when we go outside these doors. Lord, allow us to be your hands and your feet. Allow us to serve and to show love. But not just human love, the love that only you can give, Lord. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you guys. Have a wonderful, blessed week. Oh, yeah, I guess we have some more.
The speaker should be fine. Here, just don't. Here,
God from whom all blessings flow.